Today is July 19th in the year 2000. We're in the home of Paula Isenberg here in Scottsdale, Arizona, United States of America. Paula's last name at birth was Silverman. We are going to conduct the interview in English. My name is Bobby Agren Kern. Today is July 19th, the year 2000. We're in Scottsdale, Arizona, that's in the United States of America, and we have the privilege of being able to interview Paula Isenberg, Paula Silverman Isenberg. The interview will be held in English. Good morning.
Good morning to you.
Thank you for allowing us to come into your home.
Our pleasure.
And interview you. Tell us your name.
Paula Isenberg.
And your name at birth?
Was Paula Louise Silverman.
Okay. And when were you born?
I was born April 18th, 1912.
Which makes you how old today?
88.
Good. And where were you born?
I was born in Brooklyn, New York, in Borough Park, which was really a shtetl. I never knew anyone who was not Jewish until I got into school.
Interesting. Okay. Tell us your mother's name, your grandmother's name on your mother's side.
Her name was Pauline Dorn.
How do you spell that?
D as in David, O-R-N.
Okay. And your mother's father's name?
Was Louis Dorn.
And where were they born?
They were both born in Germany.
Okay. How old were they when they came to the United States?
I'm not quite sure of that. They were married.
Okay, and your mother's name?
Was Anna Dorn.
Okay, and your father's name, your grandfather?
Was Simon Silverman.
And your grandmother's name?
Was Bessie Silverman.
Okay, and your dad's name?
Edmund George Silverman.
Okay. Any siblings, brothers or sisters?
I have two brothers. The older one is Julian Silverman. He is 4 years younger than I am. And the young one is Martin Silverman, who is a rabbi. And he's 15 years younger than I am.
Are they married?
Julian unfortunately buried two wives and has three children of his own by his first wife, and
hold it. You have a question? Go ahead, just ask.
I was just thinking of something. What was your original question?
What I really would like to know, we keep the tape rolling.
Oh.
Basically, what I want to know is your sister-in-law's names.
Oh. Julian's first wife's name was Helen, and his second wife's name was Pearl.
And any children from those marriages?
There are three sons. Mm-hmm. And Martin has his wife's name is
No hintings.
Oh.
It'll come to you later probably.
Phyllis. And he has three children, two girls and one boy. The girls' names are Sarah, who lives in Hawaii, Amy, who lives in Boston, and Ethan, who lives in New York.
Great. And your other brother, his wife's name? Did you give me both brothers' names?
I gave you, yes, Martin and
Julian.
And all the
nieces and nephews?
Yes.
Okay, because we like to get
names. I think I have.
Okay. And your husband's name?
Is Kurt. No middle name.
Okay. And do you have any children and their names?
We have one child whose name is Naomi Beth. And she lives in Florida. She has one child, also a girl, whose name is Sarah Beth. She, too, is in Florida.
And what are their last names?
The last name is Morgan.
Spelled?
M-O-R-G-A-N.
And your daughter's married, what was his name?
His name was Michael.
Okay. That's good. Okay. Any other significant people that you'd like to mention? Any names like an important aunt or uncle or cousin or anybody that's really significant?
My paternal grandparents who lived close to us, who were very orthodox. In fact, Grandpa was a president of his shul, and my brother Julian and I, when we were young, spent every Shabbat dinner at Grandma's house. Grandma was a terrible cook, but she was a wonderful businesswoman. And when her husband, my grandfather, became ill with TB and went to Denver, as they all did in those days, she, on her own, went into business and saw all five of her sons get a good education.
Now, her name was what?
Her name was Bessie. That's where the Beth comes from in my daughter and granddaughter's middle name.
Did they live with you?
No, they never lived with us, but they lived close by, within walking distance.
Lucky them and lucky you.
Yes.
Tell me about your schooling, your education.
I went to public schools nearby, went to high school where I had to take a train, and then on to Brooklyn College. And when I graduated from Brooklyn College, they announced that they finally had land for a campus. During my time in college, we had classes in office buildings in downtown Brooklyn, running from one to the other. Quite an experience.
Did you get a degree?
I have a BA degree.
In what?
In English.
Okay. Anything else about your schooling you wanted to tell us?
No.
So, these were all public schools. Did you ever go to a Jewish school, private Jewish day school?
I did go. Well, yes. I have to tell you about my first experience in Hebrew school. Grandpa took me to a cheder, and the class had already been in session for a while. I went in, sat down, didn't know what they were talking about, and it seems that one of the little boys made an error, whereupon the teacher took his long stick and cracked him over the knuckles. I got up, left, went home, and swore I would never go back. However, I was jealous of my brother Julian, who went to a yeshiva and was learning something I didn't know about. So my parents saw to it that I had a private tutor, and I had a few years of Hebrew that way. Also, I went to a Sunday school. That was a Reform Sunday school, which was my mother's leaning. And I must say, I learned nothing but Bible stories. When I see what they learn today, I'm jealous.
Okay. Tell us about your profession, what kind of work you've done during your life.
I never knew what I wanted to do, even when I graduated from college. So I took a business course. That was in the Depression, and it was very difficult to get jobs, but through my father, I was able to get a secretarial job, which I detested. And after a few years, when things were bad and my salary, which had been all of $20, was cut to $18, I quit.
$20 down to $18 a week?
A week. It started, even with the degree, at $10 a week. That was good money in those days. On the $10 a week, I could pay for my lunches and even for a singing lesson. Of course, I wasn't giving anything at home. That helped. But when I quit, I went to a business school to get my speed up in stenography, which I was doing. And there I saw the stenotype machine, fell in love with it, and decided that's what I wanted to do. My dad was irked with me. He said he'd spent enough money and time on my education, so I had to do it on my own. What I did was sell stockings, and I had a friend who had a farm. She sent a crate of eggs down every week, and I peddled them amongst my friends. I managed to get six months of tuition paid, and paid for the machine. Then I ran out of money. I hadn't quite graduated, but it didn't make any difference, because from then on I had no trouble finding jobs. Most of it in the beginning were just secretarial jobs. But the war started. And I applied to become a WAC. It took a while because someone in the neighborhood decided they had me mixed up with someone else, and the Army got the wrong information on my background. That was straightened out, and I finally made it. The one smart thing I did was not say that I was a secretary, but say I was a stenotypist. From then on, everything has come to me. I've never had to look for anything. So eventually I got in, had basic training, asked where I wanted to go overseas. I said Alaska. I was sent to Hawaii. Let me go back to my first assignment. It was doing courts martial, which I knew absolutely nothing about, but I had a very nice captain who saw to it that I got into it gradually, and in no time at all, in Hawaii, I was taking general courts martial, which is the highest or most serious type. I was there for 14 months when this captain, who is now a major, was having trouble back on the West Coast getting a transcriber, a reporter. So he arranged that I come back and cover his three stations doing all the courts martial, which was wonderful, because any time they wanted me to clean latrines or do something like that, I said I was busy transcribing something for this major. So it worked out very well.
Let's go back to your growing up in Brooklyn. Describe to us your home life Jewishly.
My home life was not very Jewish. My mother had grown up in the country. Although she was born Jewish, she had no Jewish friends. There were no Jewish people in Connecticut where she was. So she went to church with the neighbors. She did not keep a kosher home. She said that when she was first married, she tried to, but my grandmother, her mother-in-law, didn't think it was kosher enough. So when she refused to eat at the house, my mother just didn't bother keeping kosher anymore. It wasn't actually until I was married that I really learned about Judaism. That, in spite of growing up in a Jewish neighborhood, I would go to the Reform service for High Holy Days. They were over quickly, so I'd go and sit alongside my grandma in the Orthodox shul. And the funny part to me was that these women who were keening and carrying on so lost their places in the siddur, and I had to find it for them. I think that was one thing that turned me in later life towards Reform Judaism.
What about your father's religion? Did he...
Yes, he attended services on High Holy Days. Of course, being a physician, his time was not his own, especially in those days when a physician was on call for 24 hours. Incidentally, my mother was a registered nurse before, but she never did work after marriage.
Did your brothers go to synagogue with your father?
Yes, they did.
And they were bar mitzvahed, the boys?
They were both bar mitzvah, yes. And I never had a bat mitzvah because they didn't do it in the Reform. Not in those days. However, on my 70th birthday, I was bat mitzvah. At the same time that my daughter was named in the temple.
Good for you. Your daughter or granddaughter named?
Daughter.
Daughter named. Good for you. Okay, would you have holidays, Jewish holidays at home? Would you observe any of the
Not very much. For Pesach, we'd go to my grandparents. Mm-hmm. No, let me correct. It was not my daughter. It was my granddaughter who was.
Yeah. That's okay. I knew.
You knew, but I
knew.
And
that's
I should
good.
Have. But I think I'm a little nervous. I don't know why. I know these facts.
You're not used to having a big camera aimed at you. But after a few minutes now, you're going to forget it, Sarah. Okay. Now what I'd like you to tell me is some of your earliest memories about hearing of the Holocaust or anti-Semitism.
It is remarkable that during the early years of Hitler's reign, I knew practically nothing. I knew they were having trouble. I knew there was a war. But the anti-Semitism was not really spoken about. And there was something every now and then in the paper, but not like what came out later. So it wasn't really until I got into the army that I learned about anti-Semitism. No, there was one other way. I was taking civil service exams, and I was passing them. The way that they took appointments in those days was to submit the first three names on the list to an agency. The agency could pick out anyone they wanted. My name was never picked out, and of course I drew my own conclusions. After I got into the army at one point, a girl came to me and said, "You know, I have to confess something to you. Before I knew you, I had never met a Jew. And I thought, and she stumbled, so I finished the sentence for her and said, you thought they had horns. And she said, yes, I really did. I think that hit me as strongly as anything did about anti-Semitism. This was a gal who came from the hills in Kentucky.
Did you have any relatives that were being affected by the Holocaust?
None that I knew, no. Because my mother's family had come over rather early, 1850s, 1860s. And there was no one with whom we were in contact on either side of my family. So this I learned after I got into service.
Was there ever any newsreels at the movie theaters about the war in Europe?
The war, but not as it related to anti-Semitism. There was shooting, and they showed you the battlefields. That's all I can remember about it.
Do you remember your parents or anybody talking about stories coming out of the Jews being killed?
No. I think those stories are rather limited to people who had relatives over there. It just didn't hit everybody.
Interesting, isn't it? Okay. How about you personally? Did you have any other than the stories you've related to us, any anti-Semitic acts done to you?
No. Yes, one. When I applied for a job in a law office, somehow or other the lawyer interviewing me did not ask for my name. He had all my qualifications, and he said, this all sounds good. I will now speak to the others in the firm. And he said, by the way, what is your name? And I told him it was Silverman. I never heard from him again.
What year would that have been?
Just before the war, or I'd say about 1940.
Okay. Did any of the Jewish people help the war effort or the Jewish problem?
Well, I heard that people were sending clothes and food to relatives. But that was the extent of it.
Okay, tell us, when you first started to think about joining the military, what motivated you to do that?
To be brutally frank, I wanted to get out of the house. I had tried to rent, not an apartment, couldn't afford that, but a room to be away, and my father said, if you do, I'll never see you again, so that took care of that.
Why did he say that?
Because nice girls didn't leave home until they were married. I was never going to get married. Not at that point. No.
So what did you do?
So, when it became possible to enlist in the army, I applied. And I made it.
Without your parents' permission?
Well, that was different. They were patriotic. That was entirely different. That they didn't object to, that I think they were somewhat proud of. Because, first of all, I was a skinny thing in those days. I have to tell you about what happened when I went for my physical. I weighed 98 pounds, and I had to have 100 pounds. What to do? They needed court reporters. So the doctor said, now go out and drink as much water as you possibly can and then come back. I did that. I got up to 99 pounds and he fudged and made it 100. Don't ask me what I weighed when I came out, though.
What year? Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I think it was 117.
tell us, I lost my friend. What year was that when you applied for the military?
It was in 43.
And how old were you then?
Oh, my, I have to figure.
Around 30.
Yeah.
31. Uh-huh. Okay. Was that about the average age that women were going
in? Oh, no, they were much younger. I'd say the majority were about 20.
Was there any problem with your last name being a Jewish last name?
No. None whatsoever.
Okay. So, did you tell them what you wanted to do?
Well, as I said, thank goodness I didn't say I was a secretary. And I said I was a stenotypist, and before I knew what had happened, I was doing reporting, one kind or another.
And what division was this?
This was Air Transport Command, which was part of the Air Force, originally known as Air Corps when I got in. And when I got in, it was known as the Women's Auxiliary Army Corps. Then in August, I believe it was, of 44. I went in 44, not 43. In August, it became Women's Army Corps, and then officially part of the Army.
You told us you went to Hawaii.
Well, after basic training, even though I asked for Alaska, I was sent to Hawaii. And that's when I really became a court reporter, because the fellow who had been a court reporter before me had been on a plane ride down to the islands, and he was an alcoholic. We traveled in freight airplanes, and there was no floor on it. And the cork of his bottle got into the machinery and almost ditched him. So he was, the first court martial that I reported was his for having done that. And we became fast friends.
Describe to us exactly what a court reporter does and how.
A court reporter is responsible for verbatim testimony at a trial, everything that everybody says, and transcribing it in certain form. It differs with different organizations.
In the 40s, what did the machine look like?
It was heavy. It became much lighter as time went on. And the Army was supposed to furnish us with machines. The one they furnished me was so old that I was glad I had my own.
We're at the end of tape one. We'll stop now, take a breath, and then we'll go on to tape two. Thank you.
How I can...
Starting tape number two with Paula Isenberg. Paula, you were telling us how the machinery, I can't even think of the name of the machine.
Stenotype.
Thank you. How it works.
Well, Well, let me give you a brief description of the machine itself. It's divided into three parts. Initially, the left hand will operate the initial consonants. Your two thumbs have four keys for the vowels. A, O, E, U. If you need an I sign, it is made by pressing E, U together in the crack. The right fingers operate the final consonants. There are many substitutes because it's a limited keyboard. You haven't got every sound where you need it. It is made by a combination of usually two keys, maybe more, pressed together. However, there are many, many abbreviations, not only for words, but for phrases. That's where your speed comes in, memorizing these abbreviations. Now you know how to be a stenotypist.
And did anybody else look at what you had typed up on the machine, or is that just for your eyes only?
Not at that time. At that time, and until after the war, I was my own transcriber. Time came when I had someone else do all my notes for me.
For example, give us an example of a phrase. Do you remember any of the short?
Yes. It's a silly phrase, and I don't know that I've ever used it, but it's possible. Is that you have been? You can do that with one stroke. S-T-H-A, F for the V, and B for been. I forgot the U, but it comes in there, too.
How fast can you actually type?
Well, that's an individual thing.
But you, Paula?
The best I have done was 230 or 240. But that was when I was going to school and really pushing. In ordinary work, you don't need more than about 175. There are some very fast talkers, but they're few and far between.
And if you didn't hear a sentence or a word?
Well, you always had access to the speaker after you finished. And I don't know whether you've seen the tape that this produces. It's like an adding machine tape, but it falls into a pocket which goes back and forth, so it doesn't take up so much room. And what we used to do, when there was a question, we'd have little red tapes that had stickum on them, and we'd have them pasted on the edge of the machine in little bits. So where there's a question, we'd grab one of those little tapes, slap it onto the tape that came out of the machine at that point so that we could find it later and ask the speaker to make the correction. You had to do that a lot with spellings of names or articles that were unfamiliar to you.
Now tell us what led up to you going to Germany, was it?
Yes. I had been discharged from the Army, and I was doing the same work in the law office in California as a civilian. I had living with me a young woman whose husband, remember this is after the war, her husband had been sent to Hawaii, and she was supposed to follow him. She already had her orders, but her orders were canceled. She had no place to go. Housing was impossible at those days. So I invited her into my little apartment. Finally, she had to go down to process to actually join her husband. I took a day's leave and went with her. I saw a door at the processing place marked overseas personnel. And I stuck my head in and I said, what do you need? Oh, you don't apply here, you apply downtown. fine, close the door. Door opened again. Woman came out. She says, what do you do? I said, I'm a court reporter. She grabbed me, took me into the office, and in pencil, I filled out a Form 57, which is the application for any government job. Next day, I had a phone call from Washington. Did I want to go to Korea? Well, I said, I would like to, but I can't because I have made arrangements to go back home now. But I am interested. So I went back home, no sooner got a job in a law office than I was contacted to go to Germany, which I accepted.
What did they tell you?
Well, they had this job for a court reporter, 1 year term, and in those days it was a grade 7, which was considered pretty good, with I believe it was 20% overseas pay. Came out rather well, especially since I was only there a few months when I was raised to a 9. So it was a good deal financially.
Keep going.
All right. Finally got to Dachau, Germany. Dachau was originally a prisoner of war camp. It was one of the very first. And at that time, when it was inaugurated, there were mostly political prisoners, a great number of whom were priests. These priests never had it as bad as the Jews, but they had to do manual work. However, at this point, it was a general prisoner of war camp where they were holding trials. Now, most people, when you mention war crimes trials, will say Nuremberg. However, for the territory that the Americans conquered, they held their own war crimes trials, which were held at Dachau. There were many different types of trials held. The first ones that I was put on to were called superior orders. They had to do with shot down American flyers. Now, these flyers came out unarmed. They were still captured, tortured, and many killed right on the scene.
By whom?
By the Germans, either the military or even the civilians. These were trials of the people who had shot them, tortured them, or done something, and they were able, the American investigation, to find these people and witnesses to testify against them. There were quite a few of those. However, there were many different trials going on, and I spent most of my time there on the one trial which was pretty famous, known as Buchenwald. Buchenwald was a death camp, similar to Auschwitz. People who went there were either worked to death or for some reason just shot. As they came into camp on these cattle trains, many died en route because these trains were always sidelined to let the German troop trains pass. So sometimes days went by with no water, no food, and no sanitary facilities. So when these trains arrived in camp, there were many dead. People were marched out of the trains, those who could still walk, and by looking at them, they were shunted either to the death camp, the death part, or those who looked healthy were shunted to barracks to be worked. Families were separated. The death camp was the gas chamber. People were told that they were going to have showers, disinfecting showers. When they were in, the place was sealed and the gas let loose. The corpses were then taken to a place where the prisoners, many Jews, had to go over, take out the gold teeth, take the hair of long hair that women had, all of which was reused. The bodies were then burned. I think of Eisenhower's visit on the second day of the liberation, when he talked about the horrible stench, the awful piles of skeleton bodies that were left in piles, and the people in the barracks that were nothing but living skeletons. How did they become so? Well, they were expendable, those people who were sent to the barracks to work. The work, for the most part, was road work, building roads. For no reason at all, these people would be whipped. That was the most common of punishments. But they would be marched everywhere. Dysentery was very, very common. But if they left the line to relieve themselves, they were beaten unmercifully. All this, of course, led to the point where they could be shifted to the death pod, because they became so very weak. They were used in other ways, too. They were used for all the manual work, cleaning of the officers' quarters, and many, many others. We had, I forget how many hundreds of witnesses in the Buchenwald case. The commandant of Buchenwald was originally a man by the name of Koch, K-O-C-H. He finally was dismissed because he had syphilis so bad. Well, he had a wife known as Ilse Koch, the bitch of Buchenwald. She was a nymphomaniac of the worst kind. Her favorite pastime was when a new load of prisoners came in, she would have the men lined up nude, looking for tattoos. This was what she loved. The most interesting tattooed person she would choose to spend the night with. He was never seen again. However, there was much testimony to the effect that, especially from one man whose friend had a very interesting boat tattoo on him, that he had been picked out by Ilse Koch, and the next time this prisoner saw the tattoo was on skin where they were working to make book covers, anything, gloves, anything that could be made of leather was how these tattoos, not only of those that Ilse Koch spent the night with, but anybody else who had an interesting tattoo.
Well, talk to me.
All right. I would like to read something about this. It's back there with the papers.
Why don't we look at it at the end of the tape?
At the end? All right, I'll do that. Buchenwald also conducted many, many medical trials of cholera, that type of disease, especially if they could get hold of twins. They would infect one and not the other to see how they reacted. Another of their horrible experiments was seeing how cold the human body could get without dying. You can imagine how horrible that was. Let me go back to the opening of the trial. There were 30 men and one woman who were all accused of crimes against humanity and were tried at the one Buchenwald trial. The first exhibit was a video of the liberation of the camp, how they found it. Just as General Eisenhower said, with these skeleton bodies still barely alive in the barracks, on the multiple levels of rest that they had. They weren't beds, they were shelves. And they had one blanket, no matter what the weather was. There are pictures of those that I have. I know you've seen some of them. They've been widely publicized. The second exhibit was a shrunken head. This was another of their pastimes. This particular head was very Semitic. It had the beard and the nose that the Jews are always favored with. And this was something that we had to carry back and forth to the courtroom every morning. It was locked up overnight until we finally, we, referring to the reporters, finally rebelled. It was just too horrible. And then it was no longer in the courtroom. The name of the trial was United States Government versus Josias Zuvaldek. He was nobility and the only one of noble rank who was tried during the Buchenwald, not only Buchenwald, but at Dachau.
How do you spell that?
Josiaszu. W-A-L-D-E-C-K. The trial went on for many months. There was so much testimony, you wouldn't believe. You know, the first time I heard a death sentence pronounced, I was physically ill. But you know, the human body can take a lot. You get used to it. All you have to do is think back of what they were accused of, and it doesn't become so very bad to hear. I have a list of the actual sentences, which I would like to read into the record, and then discuss what happened after it.
What method did they kill the prisoners?
Well, some of them were just tortured to death.
I'm talking about after the trial, after the sentencing.
Oh, well, after sentencing, it was hanging, or just hanging. But the way they tortured them during the Holocaust was hanging by their hands for hours. I understand they could last a day or more that way. Beatings, of course, applying electrical current to the genitals, cutting off the genitals. They were all methods of torture.
Did they give you any training of what you were going to witness?
None whatsoever.
During the trial?
None whatsoever.
So you had no preparation of what you were walking into?
No. That's why the first sentences were such a shock. As I say, after listening for months to the testimony, made no difference. It's what you looked for.
Now, are you saying that the actual trial was at Dachau?
Yes.
They actually had the trial at the old camp?
Yes.
Why'd they do that?
Well, they had the facilities to house people. And there were so many witnesses to... Remember, there wasn't only one trial going at a time. There may have been 6, 10, or 12 different trials going on.
Were they all... Were many at Dachau, many trials going on?
Oh, yes. All the time.
And who ran the trial?
Oh, well, let me tell you about the setup for Buchenwald. There were 8 field grade officers. That means major or above. The president was a brigadier general by the name of Kiel, K-I-E-L. Some of these men had been retired and were called back to duty to do this. They weren't capable of doing anything more. In fact, I hate to say that one very often fell asleep. They had to sit there all day, day after day. And how did we work? Oh, wait, let me go to the back to the court. There were 3 prosecution lawyers. Denson, who died recently, Surowitz, and one other, I don't remember his name. At the defense table, they had some Americans, but mostly German lawyers. There were about 6 of them, but we can check that with the book later on. This book that was given to us before the trial, the story of the investigation and the accused, pictures of all the accused, and what they were accused of. Now, we had several reporters, and what we would do was this. We'd go in for 30 minutes at a time, which meant that you went in 2 or 3 times a day, but you were relieved. Another reporter would come in and set up the machine, or we did have some stenographers. We had 2 stenographers. When they were all set up ready to go, they'd nod, we would stop, and they would continue. Go back to the typing room and type up exactly what you'd taken. Before the day was over and the last person left, it had to be typed and bound and given to the court to review. And that was our daily, day after day, month after month.
How long would it take you to type up?
We figure usually 3 times as long. So it would be 1.5 hours, approximately.
So how many times would you be in the courtroom per day?
I say 2 to 3 times a day. But I must tell you how different things were then. We didn't have any Xerox machines. We used the old carbon paper. I've asked some current reporters if they knew what carbon paper was, and they'd never seen it. We had to make about, it was 4 copies, that's 3 carbons, and if you made an error, oh boy, it was work. That's why it took 3 times as long to transcribe as to take. Looking at the dock of prisoners, I can go back to my first sight of them. the beginning of the trial, when they showed this movie, 30 men, one woman. And I didn't have anything to do with my hands while they showed the picture, so I was able to look at the prisoners. Stoic. Nobody showed any emotion except one person. He was a doctor of the camp. Can't think of his name now. Anyway, the story with this man is he'd come to the United States many years before, even become a citizen. He married a daughter of a judge from New England, but when Hitler became powerful, he went back to Germany and became a Nazi. And he showed some emotion. You know, it's often occurred to me, maybe we Americans have a little more conscience than the Nazis had. What accounted for this? He was the only one. He put his head in his hands. Be that as it may, he'd been accused of all these medical experiments. So,
and the woman,
Ilse Koch, yes.
The one woman out of this group.
It was Ilse Koch, the bitch.
Really?
Yes. She was tried at the same time. The one who loved the tattoos. Now, let me tell you about the tattoos. It so happened, they had one of them, and I had to mark it in evidence. General Clay, who was the man who had to review all the sentences, which we'll go over later, made the statement that this was not human skin. It had been proved to be goat skin. No such thing happened. It was another error that General Clay made. I'll read you something that had been written about it. Can we break now?
Well, I think it's better to do it all together.
We have to go back because I can't remember the name, the number of different sentences that were dealt out. The sad part of all this was when it came to the review by General Clay, he obviously had not read the testimony. I don't know what he really based it on, but we'll go to that later. He reduced just about every sentence. Now, Ilse Koch was no dope. She managed to get herself pregnant while a prisoner, knowing that no court would sentence her to death if she carried a fetus. And that's exactly what happened. She was given a life sentence of imprisonment because otherwise she would have had a death sentence. There was that much evidence against her. This fellow who had seen the tattoo had been working as a cleaner in her house. And he said there were lampshades with tattoos on. Unfortunately, nothing made of the human skin was available. Why? Because the GIs confiscated everything as souvenirs. Why the government didn't advertise for some of this as evidence, I don't know, but we had none.
Okay, we're at the end of tape two. We are at tape three with Paula Isenberg. And Paula, you had some quotes that you wanted to read to us, and that was related to what we were talking about.
Before the quotes, I'd like to give you the results of the trial, what was done to the defendants. There were 22 deaths by hanging, 5 life sentences, 1 20-year term, 2 15-year terms, and 1 10-year term. When General Clay reviewed it, reviewed the whole record supposedly, this is what he is quoted as saying, referring to the review of the trial record. He said, "One of the reasons I revoked the death sentence of Ilse Koch," and she was not given a death sentence, she was given a life sentence. He said, "There was absolutely no evidence in the trial transcript other than that she was a loathsome creature." And he went on to say, "I suppose I received more abuse for that than for anything else I did in Germany." Well, from that we can gather that the good general never did read the transcript, if he didn't even go over the sentences correctly. Let me go on with what happened to Ilse Koch, at least what I have been able to find out. She gave birth to a boy in prison. The boy was taken away from her, brought up by somebody, I don't know by whom. I'm sure it was a good Nazi. And many years later, when he was an adult, he decided he would try to locate his mother. Somebody must have told him the whole story in their version. He did finally locate her a short time before she died. And it was he who buried her. And that's all I could find out.
Okay. Let's go on. Let's see. Take the papers for the second. Okay.
Would you like to know about our living conditions?
Definitely.
Well, when the American girls, there were a few men, but mostly girls, who came to do the office work at the Dachau trials, arrived. By that time, civilian American men had already been housed. They had done the investigation. So they were given the quarters of the higher-ups of the concentration camp. They were centrally heated. And they had hot water. Well, when we got there, first of all, we were resented. Our GIs were having a wonderful time with the Fräuleins. A pack of cigarettes would get you most anything. Remember, they had nothing. Anyway, we were housed in what were the SS Strasse billets for the lowly people. We had our own rooms, true. There were, I think, 4 rooms to a little bungalow with 1 toilet. And the heating was a china stove. Remember, the ceilings were, oh, I guess 15 feet high. All we had for fuel was green wood, and not that at all times. There was a period of 4 days we had no heat. The pipes froze. We had no toilet facilities. We had to wait till we got to the office to do what we had to do and try to wash up a little. The temperature hovered around zero for a good part of the Bavarian winter. There was another interesting time. As I told you, the women were resented. Well, the only way you could really have a good evening was be invited by one of the GIs or one of the civilian men to come to the officers' club, where originally we ate and had the same food as everyone else. Well, this one girl was not getting her dates, and she complained that we were being discriminated against. Then they started to discriminate. They put us to eat in a house several hundred yards from the kitchen, and we got whatever was left over, which is the reason I don't like red cabbage. Finally, we had to call the Inspector General. Remember, time goes by before all these messages get up to where they're supposed to go. But we were then fed again in the officers' club. That's about it.
Were spouses allowed to come over?
Well, there were two reporters married who came together, but they're the only ones. No. There were no spouses at that time.
What other things do they provide for you? Do they provide any kind of entertainment or activities in the evenings?
No, I can't remember anything much. The only thing I remember that they did provide was one Pesach. There was a Seder, and it was primarily for the DPs, the people who were released from the concentration camps.
So they were there at Dachau?
Not at Dachau, but there was one close by.
The
entertainment. Well, they had an orchestra made up of prisoners, and they played in the officers' club for dinners. I can't forget that it was either, I think it was Newsweek, one of those weekly magazines, published an article about how well the Americans were living at the concentration camp. And at that time, we didn't have sugar, we didn't have fresh milk, and they had laid it on thick about our entertainment with this German orchestra.
So the girls that you were housed with, were they all Americans?
Yes.
Were there any other Jewish girls with
no,
you?
No, not there. I was the only one.
And how did that...
Wait a second. This couple was Jewish. I think. I'm pretty sure they were. Didn't observe anything.
Did you feel you were treated any differently or any comments made?
No.
Do you think you felt different being in Dachau as compared to the non-Jewish people?
I'm sure I did. I mean, after all, going back generations, this was my people.
How did you show it, do you think?
I don't think I did. You become hardened. It wouldn't have done me any good. I couldn't complain of my relatives that were affected. At least I didn't know of any.
So. How long did the actual trial take?
Was it 4 or 5 months? April, May, June, July, August, September, 6 months.
I have a sneeze coming on. I'll try to
go right ahead.
Swallow it. Were you able to get mail and communicate with?
Yes.
How did that work?
That worked very well. In fact, I had one long distance. No, I didn't. I didn't have any long distance telephone calls from Dachau. No. No.
Tell me again when the trial started and when it finished.
It started April of 45. Concluding date I don't have in my mind.
So it was about six,
September something.
6 to 9 months later?
It wasn't nine, I think it was six.
How did you get assigned to that one? Do you have any idea?
Well, I was out trying to blowing my own horn. I was one of the better support reporters there. I'd had more experience.
And how many were there reporters on that particular trial?
I have them.
That's okay.
I have their names, most of them. About six or eight. They changed, though.
Can you describe how the legal system worked for those trials?
Well, it was under the auspices of the Army.
The United States Army.
It followed the Army rules of courts-martial. And don't ask me just how they differed from civilian, because I'm not too aware of that. But that's why we had the American field grade officers as judges. Most of them did not have any legal experience. They were just experienced with Army life, and they'd all sat on courts martial before, I'm sure. We had some lawyers, but most of them were not.
Were there any other countries involved in the trial?
Not other countries, but we had witnesses from many countries, which became rather cumbersome. For instance, if you had a Czech person who spoke Czech, had to have a Czech interpreter who would interpret into German so your defendants knew what they were talking about, but then you had to have someone who translated from German to English for the reporters.
Was this done on earphones?
No.
No.
That Nuremberg came out with much more sophisticated ways of doing things than we did. But no, we had nothing like that.
So there'd be somebody sitting next to them whispering the...
There would be a reporter. There would be the defendant with a translator alongside with the witness's language. Then the other translator would come along or do it, you know, just follow. They'd do a sentence at a time or two sentences and then go through this rigmarole.
Do you know how the witnesses were found, the process?
There was a year's investigation from April to April, that I remember. And they used American GIs after they were discharged from the Army. And they went, followed every suggestion that was given to them, looking all over Europe for these people.
And then what would they do when they found them?
They'd bring them, not immediately, but when their turn came to testify, they would bring them to Dachau and house them. And I can tell you one thing that really got my goat. We had an old man, a typical chassid in dress, come as a witness. And he was very kosher. So he refused to eat in the mess hall. The poor man was starving. And the lieutenant, who was in charge of witnesses, made the statement that if he can't eat the food in the mess hall, he can go hungry. But it took a couple of GIs who had access to what they call C rations, which were just cheese and crackers, to feed this man for the couple of days that he was there.
Could the witnesses refuse to come to the trial?
Oh, yes. But remember, they wanted to get their stories in. They had seen so much. They had seen their whole families. Like this old man, he saw his whole family killed in front of him.
So mostly the witnesses were Jewish?
Not all. There were a couple of priests. Remember, Hitler was not only after Jews. He was after Catholics. He was after gypsies. And he was after anybody who didn't believe as he believed. So there were quite a few non-Jews.
Do you remember what the priests testified?
No, I'm sorry, I don't. Remember how many years ago this is? And what's more, I'm an old woman, and my mind is not that good anymore.
We don't believe that for a minute. Okay, and what about the role of the judge? What role did he have?
Well, he conducted the court, and occasionally, but very, very occasionally, there were questions from the members of the court to the witness, but not often. The lawyers took care of that.
What was the judge like?
Oh, he was a great guy. Very fair. He's also retired. As I said, he was a brigadier general by the name of Keel.
Did he ever have to control the group?
No.
In the courtroom?
There was never anything that was not strictly according to form. There were days when we couldn't hold court because it was so cold with the tiny little stoves that they had that it was impossible. You know, I don't know why, but when I packed to go, I packed a little muff. Those days we had muffs. And I took it on the cold days, I took it into court with me. And while they were talking in other than English, I would put my hands in the muff. That helped.
Why didn't they make it more comfortable for everybody?
Couldn't. They didn't have the fuel. They had no coal. The higher-ups got the good wood, and we got what was left. Remember, we were not favorites there, we American women.
So, what about the prisoners? Did they ever yell out or talk to each other or disrupt the proceedings?
They didn't disrupt. They whispered to each other occasionally, yes. But it wasn't disruptive.
Were they influencing each other? Did you have a sense?
No. I don't think so.
Were they united or were they not?
I suppose so. But if I were to characterize them, I would characterize them as apathetic. You saw no emotion. The only emotion you ever saw was from this one Dr. Kogan, I think his name was. I forgot to check that. And Ilse Koch, she glared at the women. It was so funny. She didn't glare at the men, but she glared at the women. See, in her youth, she must have been rather attractive, redhead. But she was a mess.
Was there a leader amongst the prisoners, did you feel?
No. But she sure got what she wanted.
Where would they sleep at night?
In barracks. I never saw their, I never actually saw their quarters.
Were they guarded at all times?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. But how much they were guarded that she managed to get pregnant, I don't know.
You think their living quarters were better than yours?
No, I'm sure they were not.
Were they all in one big barracks?
I don't know. As I say, I never got to their quarters.
Did they testify, the prisoners?
Each one. Each one was tried separately.
Did they ever apologize? Did any of them ever say?
No. The thing that you heard, both in superior orders and also somewhat in the Buchenwald case, was they were just following orders. They felt if they hadn't followed orders, they themselves would have been killed.
So there was no time that any of them ever said it was a terrible thing we did?
Never.
And there was no way of breaking that?
No. We had the evidence.
Did any of them yell, get upset when they were being questioned?
No, no.
Do you think they denied anything that you had evidence was
true?
Oh,
yes.
For example?
Well, there may have been individual beatings or things like that. They would say, oh, no, they never did that. But for the most part, they didn't. It was cut and dried.
Did the doctor deny some of the work he had done on prisoners?
I did not take his testimony. See, as it was, you got bits and pieces. So it's very difficult to say because we didn't really have time to read the whole record.
Would they show the prisoners photographs, evidence of what was going on, even though the prisoners were denying it?
There were not very many pictures shown. Not at least when I took it. As I say, I was there for the video of liberation, but very little else.
What evidence was put into court, put into the records? What kinds of evidence?
Marches, beatings, the evidence of how they were mistreated, the different punishments that were meted out. But they varied. I think I've given you most of them.
What were they on trial for? What were the counts?
Crimes against humanity. That was the overall crime, the overall charge.
But what about their defense that it was during wartime?
They were following orders.
So we said that they went above and beyond?
Well, if the orders were against humanity, they had no business doing them, according to your international law.
Were you able to go into the courtroom, or did you have time other than when you were taking notes?
Practically never. There was always something to be done. Like, remember, to set up your paper with three carbons, we had to have that ready to type. So there were a lot of little things that you had to do other than actually sit there and type.
What would be the hours of the trial, from what to what?
Oh, gosh. I think we started at 9, and I think it was 9 to 4:30 or 5. I don't remember.
And they provided your meals while you were there?
And
housing, whatever limited that was, plus a small salary.
Salary was good.
And would you keep the salary or send it back to America?
Both.
Did you?
Bought a lot of things.
In Germany?
Yes.
Like what?
Well, people needed money to buy food. It was not exactly legal. We were allowed one carton of cigarettes a week, and it was very illegal to barter, but everybody did it.
Did you
buy? See, I think the statute of limitations has passed. I'm safe in saying it.
It has. Would you buy the carton of cigarettes, or were they?
We bought them, I think, for a dollar and a quarter.
That's what I was going to ask.
Yes.
And then you would barter them with the German civilians?
Yes. And paid for help. You could get household help, you know, do your laundry and keep your place clean. So it was not a hard life, except for the weather.
So you would go out of the camp?
Oh, yes. We took weekends off and had accumulated leave time. Oh, yes. In fact, I went to Eagle's Nest, Hitler's Eagle's Nest.
Tell us what that is.
Well, it was his vacation place, and it was built into a mountain. And he had an elevator that went from ground level up through the mountain to his, what was left of it. It was a room that must have had nothing but glass walls and overlooked the whole countryside. It was, the scene was gorgeous, but the place was a mess because it was bombed out completely. And we, a lot of the people learned to ski there. I never had the guts to do it. And, you could make a very pleasant life for yourself. However, to go into Munich, now Dachau is a suburb of Munich. In those days, it was level. There was hardly a building standing. What was worst about it, you're used to seeing pictures of rubble and buildings down, but the stench. Mm. It was terrible, just walking the streets in the summertime, you know, when weather was getting warmer. And I remember one night they were having an opera in the opera house, what was left of it. There was only a partial roof left on it, but they did have the stage. And we came in, I was with some people, and we were ushered into the president's box. Everybody looked up at us, a very uncomfortable feeling. Oh.
What a wonderful experience.
Wonderful.
Be able to hear the music in the middle of all this trial.
Yes, it was a break.
Right, we're at the end of tape 3, and we'll stop here and stretch, and then we'll come back to tape 4. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Tape 4 with Paula Isenberg. Paula, tell me why there was no jury on this trial and what they did have.
This trial was held under the auspices of the Army. And in regular courts martial, there is never a jury. It is one or more judges who make the decisions. And here there were 8 judges.
And you might have told us, but I don't remember, how were those 8 judges selected? Was that political?
I have no idea. The Army selected them. They were all, as I said, of field grade rank, major or above, with the one general as a president.
And so after all the testimony, they got together in private chambers?
Correct.
And how long did it take them to deliberate?
I don't remember.
And when they came back and gave the verdicts, were you, I think you were there during some of the
yes.
results. Was there an audible sound with each one in the room?
No, I don't recall any reaction. I don't know whether I was there for the sentencing. I just don't remember. I'm sorry.
No. No women judges.
No.
Unheard of? That,
at that time?
In those days?
No. There were field grade officers in the Women's Army Corps, but I don't know why there were none on the... I don't remember ever seeing one there.
It would be different in the year 2000.
Exactly.
Now, did you say some of these judges were or were not lawyers?
I don't really know their background. I understand that some of them were, but not all.
Did they speak during the trial?
Sometimes they questioned. They would get permission from the president to question, but it was very rare.
And how was the president chosen? Do you have any idea?
I have no idea of how that panel came to be.
Mostly older people were judges?
Yes. Most of, I do know that most of them were retired.
Really?
Yes.
And they brought them back in?
They were called back, yes.
Mm-hmm. Why do you think that is?
Experience, I hope.
Could be. Okay. Is there anything you can tell us about the debates on any of the subjects, any of the discussions held, any of the arguments that you remember that might be interesting to us?
I don't remember any details. Of course, there were arguments of law, points of law, but I can't specifically call any one to mind.
Did you feel your sense of feelings towards the German people changing during your stay there?
Oh, yes. Except I had a housekeeper, cook, whatever she was, and she was a good soul. However, you could not believe everything she said. Now, for instance, and this we heard from several people who lived right near Buchenwald or lived near Dachau, which also had a crematorium, they swore they never smelled anything. And we know as a fact that the odor, when they burned bodies, wafted for many miles.
So
I couldn't completely trust this woman.
Why was she saying that?
I suppose so she wouldn't be questioned. I don't know.
But you trusted her?
I trusted her not to steal anything. She never did. But I wouldn't ask her what she did during the war or how she lived. I didn't want her testimony. I didn't want to know from her because I wouldn't believe it. I was still the enemy. Remember that.
Did she treat you as such?
No, she was a very kind person. She did very well for me.
How old was she approximately?
Young middle age. 40, I'd say.
Did she ever talk about her father or brothers?
No personal talk. No.
Did she speak English?
A few words. I could speak a few words of German. She could speak a few words of English, so we managed.
How did you learn German?
It was a requirement in Brooklyn College, a year and a half of German.
Why?
Why? In those days, you had to have a certain amount of math that took you through calculus, and 4 years of English, and so much science, and so much language. And German was one of them.
Required.
German, a Romance language, and Latin. Things have changed.
Okay. Who did you report to? Who was your boss?
One of the court reporters. Chief court reporter.
Why was that person chosen, do you think?
I don't know, but he was there before any of us. And unfortunately, he was caught bartering a little too much and was tried. Ooh. This is subsequently.
About how many people would be in the room? I mean, would there be like visitors?
Yes, there would be always visitors. I have a picture taken in the courtroom. It's hard to make out individuals, but you can see the heads was taken from the back. I'm the reporter. You can see the bench with the judges and the prosecution and defense tables.
So who else would be in the room?
People who had time on their hands for being the audience. I mean, Americans didn't bother to come in very often. I mean, most of them were working. They were there working, and work took up most of the time.
Do you think there were German civilians?
Oh, yes.
That would come in?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
I don't understand that.
Why?
Why were they there? Why were they interested?
See what the Americans were doing to their brothers and sisters? I mean, I don't know. But they're definitely Germans in that picture. You can tell by the haircut.
What kind of haircut do they have?
Oh, they must have put a bowl on their heads and cut around it.
How about press?
We had press occasionally, not too often. See, this is very peculiar. Nuremberg was covered. Nuremberg was written about extensively. There is one book published about Dachau, and I finally tracked it down at the museum in Washington. Of course, this goes back several years. This fellow he came after I had already left, and he insisted it was the most difficult job he ever did. To me, it was the easiest. And he talks in his book about several of the reporters I knew. He subsequently married a German girl. He makes a statement several times that the trials were unfair and that some of the testimony was false. But then he married the German girl, so this it's not all kosher.
Did he say this verbally, or did he write this?
In the book. I have the name of the book. And if you want to read it, there is a copy of it in Aaron Scholar's office. I gave him my copy. He didn't want it on the shelves, because I'm afraid it would have disappeared.
What's the name of it, do you know? Something about Dachau? That's okay. We can talk about it later. This is just for my own personal.
It's there.
Okay. But what about the articles that were appearing in newspapers,
well,
locally?
Subsequently, when this, just as every Army trial had to be reviewed by even higher authority, this was reviewed by General Clay. I read you the little business that General Clay had said about the trial. However, as I said, he had cut all the sentences. Just how he cut them, I have no record of and haven't been able to find it. However, there was a big hullabaloo in all the papers. My parents saved all the New York papers relating to it, and I was still there, and I have articles from Stars and Stripes, which is the Army paper. I have them all in one book. Denson, the chief prosecutor, was furious, and there's a long article where he claims rightfully that the testimony was damning and that the sentences were fair. And Sorowitz, too, had a long article in one of the other papers. But no one paid attention to it. And I don't know who died, if anybody, actually. I don't know. I have no way of finding out.
Really?
Yes.
There are no witnesses of the hangings?
I don't know.
Wow.
I have not been able to find anything. Of course, I've not gone through the German papers.
Yeah.
And I wasn't there for most of the carrying out of sentences, if they were carried out. So it's all up in the air, as far as I'm concerned.
Isn't that interesting?
Mm.
No recording to your knowledge of photos of them?
I don't know. I don't know. The most I was able to find out was what happened to Ilse Koch.
And she was in prison till the day she died.
I don't know if it was until the day she died, but I know that's what she was sentenced to.
That would be interesting to research.
Yes. I have, unfortunately, the time nor the means.
Well, that's interesting. Okay.
Anything else?
Well, any other important courtroom incidences that you remember?
I don't think so. It was quite an experience. That's about it.
Interesting for you, personally?
Oh, of course. Opened my eyes. Because I didn't realize what was going on before. I had to hear this to really realize how bad it was.
Did you believe it?
Oh, I believed it after hearing from so many people, hearing the same thing, and seeing the emotion of the witnesses. Because so many of them broke down on the stand.
Uncontrollably break down?
No. I mean, they've been through it in their minds so many times, you know. There's a certain amount of control there.
Did you have a camera with you?
Yes.
So you
not in the court, though.
So
pictures of
You didn't take any pictures of the witnesses or the...
No, couldn't. They wouldn't permit that.
But you took pictures outside the
courtroom? Oh, yes. The entrance to the camp, which was, I think, similar to every other concentration camp, with the words, Arbeit macht frei. In other words, work makes you free.
How much were you writing home or writing to your friends in America?
Fairly regularly. I've always been a good correspondent until email came on.
Were you describing what you heard and saw?
To an extent. Not in detail. I don't remember whether we were told not to or what. You know, it's been a hell of a long time.
Do you remember approaching your parents to ask them if they knew what was going on?
No. Uh-uh.
Do you remember talking to them when you got home, what their reaction was? If they were defensive at all?
Oh, not defensive. My parents knew. My father was very active in getting the Salk vaccine to Israel, to the orphanages. He and other doctors cut their quota and sent the stuff.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm. That's legal, but statute of limitations gone, and he's dead.
Well, you must be proud of that.
Of course I am.
Well, I think you've done a nice job here, Paula, on the trial.
Well, I don't
I'm wondering
know.
If there's anything else. If there are people who've never heard of this trial, have never read about it.
That's it. And so many people have asked me why I didn't write about it, because I only heard a fraction of it. And I've never had the opportunity to research the rest of it, which would mean reading other testimony. It's a monumental task, and I wish somebody would do it, but I'm not the person.
What did you learn from the trial?
How cruel people can be to one another. And I hope I am much more tolerant now than I was before. I think I am. It did give me a little ability to look at the other fellow's side. Not to agree necessarily, but to try to understand. Try to understand what following orders meant. Just how far does one go beyond one's conscience because he's following orders? And what respect I have for the people who, in spite of everything, helped our Jews to survive.
And they're out there.
Some of them. But we're getting to the point where people with any personal or first person or second person knowledge are dying out. So what about the next generation? I don't know. It's history to them, like the Civil War was to us. We don't feel anything about the Civil War, and our children won't feel anything about the Holocaust.
But your testimony today will help make it a little more authentic and real to them.
With my making mistakes like that, I wonder.
Do you buy German products?
No. I must tell you one funny story. Kurt once bought a German car. And guess what? It was a lemon. So that sort of finished.
And yet you came home, back to America.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm jumping, but and married Kurt.
Well, he was affected by it. Let him tell you his story.
But you married a German, a German Jew.
I have nothing against German Jews.
Do you think you were attracted to him because of your trial experience?
Well, we found we had a lot in common. We had music and even pictures of, I showed you pictures of our family, one on one side and one on the other.
How did you meet?
Oh, dear. It was like this. I was a reporter at Workman's Compensation in New York City, and those of us who were in Germany, the few girls had kept up their acquaintance, and we were all meeting in Washington because two of them lived in Washington. So, I said to the girls I was friendly with, I'm going to Washington, leaving here tomorrow after work. We're working half a day. And this girl came in the day I was leaving and said, my cousin is waiting in his store for your telephone call, and you'd better call or he'll be there all night. And that was the beginning. And the first date we had, we went to an outdoor movie, but I was very vain, and in those days I was very nearsighted. So I took my glasses off. I still don't know anything about the movie. And it just went on after that. I put my glasses on, so he wasn't too bad looking, you know. Oh, yes, and when I had him come to one girl's apartment, the whole crowd was in the others because I didn't know what was going to show. So he came, picked me up at the apartment, and would go down and get into his car, and lo and behold, it's a duplicate of mine. You see, all these things fell into place.
This was the shirt. I did have one question I was going to ask about the trial. Was there a psychiatrist involved in the trial?
No. If there was during investigation, I have no knowledge of it.
And who was probably the most famous person you saw during that time?
You mean of the defendants? Well, that was Ilse Koch.
Okay.
Everybody knows about the bitch.
We do now.
Uh-huh.
We do now. Okay, now this was the biggest trial that you were involved in while you were there, but you were involved in other trials?
As I mentioned in the beginning, superior orders. There were so many of those of shot down America flyers who were unarmed but were tortured, killed, prisoners of war, everything.
So this Buchenwald trial was your first trial when you went there? No.
No, it was way along.
Were there any other names for any of the other trials?
That was the biggest one that they ever had there. The others were small trials, and I don't know whether any that happened in the American sector was sent to Nuremberg. I don't know.
About how many other trials did you take notes for?
Oh, gosh. Innumerable. I can't tell you that. Some lasted just a couple of hours.
Oh.
And we worked every day, 5 days a week.
And they were all held in Dachau?
The American war crimes trials, yes.
And that's what you were involved in?
Yes. Nuremberg was an international affair.
Did you work for any other trials other than American trials?
Not there. No, I was hired by the Army and wore a uniform.
Oh, you did? Why?
Oh, yes. Everybody who was working for the Army wore the uniform.
Even though you were not
in We were civilians, yes.
Yeah. What did your uniform look like?
I'll show you a picture of it.
Okay.
It was sort of, it was khaki, dark khaki, and had a an Eisenhower jacket, you know, the short one. And we had insignia on our shoulder, American insignia.
Any other way these trials affected you?
I think I've told you pretty much. I think it has changed me. But.
Okay. Now, when you came back, did you talk about it?
I did. But it wasn't until I came here 20 years ago.
To Arizona?
To Arizona. And a woman I had met who is a judge in Phoenix and also taught law at Arizona State found out that I had been a reporter there and sort of made a public speaker of me. I'd never spoken before, but she had me speaking to her 101 classes, her beginners. And from then on, I was called by schools and other groups to speak to them.
What message do you give to the children in schools?
How we must not be cruel to each other was the main one. And to think more, how we'd feel in someone else's shoes. Mm. But I could not tell them. Just one little boy came up to me and he said, "Well, just how did they torture them?" And I would not go beyond beating. I'm sorry. They'll learn plenty as they get older. Mm-hmm. These are mostly early junior high or late public school classes.
And what message do you give to the adults?
Oh, there I laid it all on, everything I've told you. Of course, I had to, at that time, it wasn't such popular knowledge that people were transported in groups in cattle cars, and that part I definitely gave the adults. So they'd known how, in the beginning, anybody who didn't look healthy was shunted off immediately for death. Pictures of the crematorium at Dachau. And when we got there, you could see the black stains of blood on the sides of the ovens. They cleaned it up after that.
They left the ovens? The ovens were there when you were there?
Definitely. They're still there. I understand.
Is it a museum or is it left for?
It's a sort of museum. They have a figure in effigy hanging by its wrists. I don't know what else they have now.
Why did you decide to tell your story to Shoah?
Shall I say because you got in touch with me? No, anything that will keep the memory alive, I will be glad to do. I'm afraid, to see it die the way our history of the past has died.
You think we'll have a war again? Think
we'll inevitably.
Have a Holocaust again?
God willing, not a Holocaust. I don't know. Man is very inhuman. And we don't know what's going to happen. Look what goes on in other countries, even today, after the Holocaust. So, are we going to be immune? I don't know.
Clocks. Okay, I do want to make sure we talk about your daughter and your granddaughter a little bit. So we'll stop this tape. And we'll start another one. And then also on the other tape, we'll show the pictures from,
yeah. All right.
From your material. 5 with Paula Isenberg. And here we have sitting next to her, her husband, Kurt Isenberg, husband of many years. How long have you been married to this young man?
47.
And what can you tell us about him?
Well, I think I told you how we met. And, of course, I can understand what he's been through when he had to leave his career and couldn't continue, but let him tell you all about that.
So what do you think of this lovely lady?
Well, the positive sides will outweigh the negative sides, no doubt about it. So it was, I wouldn't say love at first sight, but something clicked right away. And we got used to each other after a short while, got engaged, and we got married within, 6 months or something like that. Right.
It was more
we
than
didn't,
that.
We didn't have a long courtship, so.
We didn't have a long courtship because he was living in Washington and I was in New York. And his store was open Saturday evening, so I had to travel.
That's right. Became not too expensive, but very inconvenient. So we made it convenient. So, yeah. No regrets. Everything's fine.
So the one question I was going to ask was, what is your response when people say the Holocaust never happened?
I wish that person could have been where I was and heard directly from the mouths of people who suffered, how they suffered and what they suffered, and the people they lost, they would change their tune. The only people who say that it didn't happen weren't there. And while I was there only through a second, I believe.
Do you have any thoughts about when people say the Holocaust never happened?
Well, apparently those people are not, well, put it mildly, not intelligent enough to really know and absorb what they read and hear and see. So you can't really argue with them. These people are in a different category, a different level altogether. You can't convince them. They have their own minds. And you can't ignore them, but it would be nice if you could. But luckily they're the minority, and they have to live with it. That's all.
Anything else you want to say to each other?
Each other?
I think we better not do it on video.
To each other, well, we survived the Holocaust. We survived 47 years of marriage. What more do you
expect? Another Holocaust? Would you consider that a Holocaust?
No, I say first the Holocaust and then the 47 years. So, what else is there to say? Things have been good. Could have been better. Maybe yes, no. We're happy. We're satisfied.
It's been good.
It's been good.
Oh, yes.
Okay, we're going to look at some pictures and articles.
Yes.
Okay, tell us when you got this and anything about it you'd like us to hear.
This booklet was given to everybody involved in the Buchenwald case shortly before it started. It has a short history of the investigation leading up to the trial and a picture of every one of the 31 defendants plus what they were charged with.
Okay, tell us what this is.
There are two pictures, one in profile and one straightforward, the same as with all the other defendants. She was the only woman in the case. And by the time she got to trial, She was much worse looking than she looks in this picture. Her hair, which originally was red, was streaky gray, and she had lost a lot of weight. You can see the glare in her eyes that she favored us women reporters with. This you'll want.
Okay, why don't you tell us about this black and white picture with the, it's running.
This is a picture of the courtroom for the American war crimes trials at Dachau. Note the 48 stars in the flag, of course, before Alaska and Hawaii. To the back, just under the flag, is the court of 8 judges. To the right, there's a table for the prosecution. To the left, a table for the defense. The witness is sitting with his back to the aisle, and I'm sitting to the right at my little machine working away.
Okay. Ready.
This is a page from Stars and Stripes, the paper of the Army. Trial of 31, they call them colorful Buchenwald killers. In the picture, the woman is Ilse Koch. I don't know who was just under her picture, but the others are several of the defendants, several of the 30 who were in the dock. The man with the paper trying to hide is Dr. Kotzen Ellenbogen, who was in charge of the hospital where they did these horrible experiments.
Okay. Ready.
The picture you are looking at now is that of the crematoria at Dachau, which was in use when it was used as a concentration camp. Unfortunately, when I arrived, I could still see signs of dried blood on the inside of the ovens.